and then we're gonna make it work. All right, go ahead.
As I was saying, this is your ninth book, but it is your first novel. And, you know, the depth in the content of this book sets it apart from all the others that you've done. So kind of tell us about it.
Yes. Like you said, this is my first middle grade novel, my first big hefty novel. And I wasn't planning on writing this. I wrote a lot of children's books, a lot of picture books. I wrote a couple other books and types of books. I never really thought about writing a novel per se. It was always in the back of my head that maybe one day I can write for adults or whatever. But it wasn't my intention to actually write this book. So I think that's why God was like, okay, you don't intend to write it, but I'm going to set it up so that you have no choice but to write it. And so it was really interesting. And then I just met a lady one day from a book show, and we got to talking, and we were talking about how teachers can impact students positively as well as negatively. And she, you know, she was appraising my books that they're very positive and that they are very beneficial for children. And then she told me a story of how she, when she was younger in the third grade, had a friend, their class went on a little trip downtown in Charleston, South Carolina, and the child made a comment, and the teacher kind of rebuffed his comment and said something so negative that she believes that it spoke over his life in a way, in that he ended up in jail for a while. And when I heard the story, of course, it broke my heart, because, you know, you don't want children to hurt, and you feel the hurt when children hurt. And her story stayed with me. I don't know why, but it just stayed with me for a while. I couldn't get it out of my head. And I just figured that I have to do something to kind of redeem that child for what happened to him, what that teacher did to him. And as a teacher myself, you know, I understand that you don't say those things to a child. And so it came to me that I'll just write about it. And that is one of the main points in this book. The story is actually in this book. It's a part of the book because I thought it was very important to bring it out. And so this book, although it is funny, although you know, kids are going to enjoy, it's a page turner, kids are going to enjoy it, it does touch on a lot of issues that I think is necessary to talk about today. It talks about how we feel about ourselves, our self-confidence. It talks about racism that's going on today and how our kids are dealing with it. It talks about self-control, teaching kids how to tap into their powers, to control their behavior, to control themselves. And also teaches children that they have the power to make a difference. They can actually exercise those powers that they have and make a difference in this world. So this book touches a lot of different things, but it is poignant, it is purposeful, and it is enjoyable to be a good read for middle graders.
And I mean, you said a good read for middle graders, but I'm definitely far from that. And I thoroughly enjoyed the book. So let's jump back to that a little bit. Other than middle graders, who would you recommend reading this book?
Oh my. So I would definitely recommend parents read the book as well. Only because it will give you ideas of conversations you might want to have with your child. Your child might be going through things that you have no idea about. So it's important to have certain conversations with your child. and how to have those conversations also. I know my son read the book, and there is an antagonist in this book that's a teacher. One of the antagonists in this book is a teacher. And so he said to me, this teacher remind me of another teacher I had, but I had no idea. And I had no idea that he was getting these feelings from one of his teachers. And so he never said anything about it. I had no idea. And a lot of it is because I think a lot of children don't know how to voice what they're going through. So parents can read this and then ask some questions, you know, like, I read this book. It was talking about how, you know, the student was feeling in the class and things like that. Well, how do you feel? Talk to me about that. Is there anything that you need to tell me about? And, you know, start having these conversations. And so I think it's great for parents to read it. This is an excellent book for classroom discussions. So for teachers who want a novel that they can have, Socratic seminars with, to have discussions about, there are so many different areas of this book to pull from and to create an entire lesson over, around. So I think this is also great for teachers to bring into the schools and to really have great discussions with children about what's going on, you know, in their lives, in their daily lives, as well as what's going on around us in society.
As I was saying before, I enjoyed the book as an adult. What it reminded me of was how lucky I am, fortunate to have really great teachers. It took me back to high school, and I remember certain teachers like Miss Mail, who took us to see Maya Angelou. And of course, at that time, I didn't realize how significant that was to be in the same room with Maya Angelou. She took us to see an exhibit on the diary of Anne Frank. There are counselors who, you know, I think of Miss Ruth Jackson, who have said to me, you know, do you know that you can sell your art? And if she hadn't said that, I would probably never sold my art. So the book is just a reminder of the power that teachers have to speak positivity, or unfortunately, negativity over someone's life. So kind of take us through the book and talk about the characters, the two degrees of teachers that you brought forth in the book.
Yes, we do have some incredible characters in this book. We have a lot of students, several students in this book also. Moses is the main character, and he gets to go through all, you know, a kind of a tough time in his life with us. And he meets some students, some who are very supportive and some who are antagonistic towards him. And he has to figure out how to deal with them. On top of that, he has a teacher that is very antagonistic towards him, really every day he has to deal with her microaggression in the classroom. But he also has a wonderful teacher that really talks about what is going on and really try to help the entire class understand their, to understand how to think better, how to really tap into what's going on in our society and become better thinkers about what's going on. And so he's a great teacher in this book. And I as well have had some great teachers in my life. And so it was easy to create this character because I remember like my third grade teacher, Mrs. Ross, and my fourth grade teacher, Mrs. Cooper. They were just amazing because, you know, that was the first time there were two black female teachers, first of all. And I was new to this country because we, you know, we were born in Jamaica. I was new to this country. I was new to Harrisburg. And I came to school like on the third grade, like halfway between third grade starting. And so I was like behind. And I know Miss Ross kind of took me under her wing and got me started and got me caught up to the other students. And then it was just great to have these Black women just wrap their arms around me and really help me to learn the country and to learn what I needed to learn to progress, you know? And so in this book, there was a period where this Mr. Khan, he's a good teacher, and he tries to make them understand, you know, their place in the world. And then he does this experiment with the kids, and they finally realize that, oh, wait a minute, I think we are actually puppets in this world. And so Moses, I told you, Moses is a great, he's just a sweet kid, and kids are going to love him. It doesn't matter who you are, you're going to fall in love with Moses. He writes poetry to kind of get through all the struggles that he's getting through. And in this book, he wrote a poem called Puppet. And this was after he had that conversation with Mr. Khan. So I'm going to read that one for you right now. It's called Like a Puppet.
What page is that on again?
That page is on 173 in the book.
Okay.
All right. So he says, here's the truth and nothing but the truth. We apologize if it hurts you. We tell you what you need to hear to make our position clear, to make you jump in the air like a puppet. We leave some things out to keep our clout and make you shout like a puppet. We know it's a sin, but we must win. So we keep you on a string like a puppet. So it's up to you, cut the strings in two or stay subdued like a puppet. And so, you know, when you get clarity, when you get clarity of where you actually stand, it kind of launches you into growth. And throughout the book, he's struggling a little bit throughout the book. He's struggling to find his identity. He's struggling to figure out how to navigate this new world that he's in. And he's struggling to figure out how to deal with the new structure of his family because his family is changing. And so throughout the book, you see where he becomes clear and clearer about what's going on and how he should stand in that moment or in those moments.
Yes. One of the things you said, you can't help but fall in love with Moses. From the beginning, it's like I became him. This is one of those books that is going to captivate you from the beginning. So when you do start to read it, make sure you have time. Because for people who are fast readers, they probably can get through it in a day. Unfortunately, I'm not. And I told you, Nadine, I started reading the book and I didn't want to put it down, but then night came and I had to choose between sleep and the book, and sleep won so that I was able to finish it the next day. But it's one of those books that once you pick it up, you're not going to want to put it down until the end, which is my favorite part, by the way, the end, but I'm not going to say anything else. Did you want to share any other poetry or excerpt from the book?
Sure. Like you said, it is a page turner, and I'm not just saying that because I'm the author, but yes, it is a page turner, and I think whether you're adult or you're a middle grader, I think you're going to enjoy the book. I can read, let's read from from the beginning of the book. And so we know that this book is about Moses who, you know, something happens and then he has to kind of move to a new area where he encounters racism for the first time. And it's also where he starts to really look, you know, there's a point in time where you don't really think about yourself as much. But there's a trigger in our lives where we can kind of pinpoint where we started, you know, thinking about what our blackness really means. And so this is one of those, the first inkling where he starts to kind of think about this. So he moves to a new area, and there's a boy, he's looking out the window, there's a boy outside, and his dad is just like, go and talk to him, you need to make friends, you know. And he's like, I don't want to go out there. And his dad is like, listen, just go and talk to him and see, you know, see what school he goes to, et cetera, et cetera. So Moses goes out to talk to the boy. And this is the conversation that they have.
What page are we on?
We're on page 20 in the book.
Thank you.
All right. It says, the boy could be my age, but he's definitely taller. His James 23 jersey hang loose like his long, sweaty hair. He can hoop. I couldn't make any of the shots he's making. The basket looks as high as the real thing, too. He has one of those portable ones with a cement block on the bottom to keep it from blowing away. I shuffle across the street and wave like a dodo. Hey, what's up? Hey, dude. He passes the ball between his hands. Y'all moving in? Yeah, I was unpacking. I'm Moses. Danny, he sinks the three-pointer. You go to Southern Academy? Only nerds go there, Danny says. I got into Bell Charter High this year. Oh, I wipe the burn off my face. Where do you go? I used to go to Bell Middle, but I'm starting Southern Academy on Monday. My bad, dude, he chuckles. I didn't mean what I said. I didn't think you would be going there. Why? He scratches his head. No reason. I know there's a reason, but I don't press. What grade you in? I'm in eighth. Ninth. You ball? He stretches his arms out with the ball. Nah. Let me guess. You play football, running back, right? Nope. Soccer? I shake my head. Then what do you play? Nothing really. For real? This is why I didn't want to come over here. It's not my fault I'm horrible at sports. Dad's 6'2", bald black dude who only plays golf, which he learned to get clients, rich clients with stocks and bonds. I have to finish packing before my dad has a fit. See you around. Okay, dude, good luck at Southern. He says it like I'm going to need some luck. I hurry back to my house feeling like a non-athletic dud.
Yeah.
So this is where he kind of, you know, start thinking a little bit about, wait a minute. Why, you know, like what happened here? There's something going on here with this conversation. I don't really know what's going on, but he senses something is going on with this conversation. And so he writes a poem after this, and it's called What Do I Play? And I'm going to read that one for you. He says, 5'1", smart, skinny, and black. The rhymes I write are never whack. Give me a pen and I'll draw you a sketch. Give me your dog and I'll teach him to fetch. Math whiz and an English scholar. I'll make a meal, so take this dollar. I know all the poets from Brooks to Baldwin and all the dreamers from Tubman to King. My mind is sharp and I am strong. I can run a race 5 miles long. I'm an honest guy and always fair. If you need something, I'll gladly share. All these gifts ooze out of me, so much so they're easy to see. But when we met outside today, all you asked is, what do I play? So that's one of the poems from the book as well.
Thank you. Yes, I do remember reading that section and noticing the stereotyping on both, from both characters. All right. So as far as getting a copy of the book,
yes,
go about doing that at this point?
Oh, this book is ready to be bought. So I'm so glad they came in the mail. They look absolutely beautiful. I just love, love, love them. And I think everyone's going to love them as well. They're available at iwriterhymes.com, or they can go to my my standard website, which is 123 Mango Tree, where they can see all my other books as well that I have published over the years. So the book is ready, and they also get a wonderful, wonderful bookmark to go along with their book. So they can go ahead and do that at any time. Also, between now and next Saturday for 1 week, there is a special coupon available. Just put in I Write Rhymes. That's your coupon code, and then you get 20% off the book. So put in I Write Rhymes as the coupon code between today and next Saturday, and you'll get 20% off your books. So go ahead and do that. That's a special, special, special offer for you guys today.
And what I love about it is that it's a hardback book. So it feels really good in your hand. But what if I don't want a hardback book? What are my options?
Oh, so it's a hardbound book, yes. And I only deliver in the United States. So if you are out of the United States and would like a PDF copy of the book, you can also order that from the website as well. And if you have any questions, any trouble, just email me at Nadine@123mangotree.com. And I'll be able to answer any questions that you have.
I do remember from your other books that you have made significant donations to children in need, whereas if someone is not interested in purchasing the book for themselves, they can actually purchase it for someone else, right?
Yes, yes, yes. So with my first book, Last Night I Dreamt I Was a Doctor, I had this program where there are a lot of people who would stop by my booth and everything and say, you know what, I don't have any children this age, but I love your books. And so I would say, well, what you can do is buy it for a child. And so what I do, I take the book, and I will donate it to children. And I donate from here all the way up to Maryland. I find organizations, I find shelters where books are needed, and I donate and I take care of the shipping and all that stuff. I donate the books to that. So if you want to Cash App me at I Write Rhymes, though, $17.95 for the book. Not only will I donate one book, I will match your donation and add a book to it. So you're actually purchasing two books for the price of one to be donated to the children in need. So that's something you can do. Again, you can Cash App I Write Rhymes, and that $17.95 will actually pay for two books. All right. And it's just something. It's something that I love doing. And there are sometimes kids come to my booth and they want my books. And so this gives me a chance to say, what? I know you might not have the money now, but here, take the book, read it, enjoy it. So I do that as well.
Thank you for doing that. So there are people who might want to meet you live, and you having some upcoming events?
I have an event coming up at the Walter Burr Public Library, November 20th, from 11 a.m. to 12 noon. So stop in for and meet and greet. You can buy books there, and that will be coming up. And I'll have more events on my website. So if you want to know where I'll be, just check out my website, and we'll go from there.
And that way they can have their books signed in person as well.
Yes, yes. Then you can have your book signed as well there. And if you order a book, I think there's a notes area on the book. If you, when you're ordering the book, there's a notes area that you can put requests. So if you want your book signed, just put that in there and I will sign the book for you.
Do you have are there any questions from anyone or?
Yeah, well, let me just thank a lot of people have helped me get to this point. You know, Jehovah has been a ride in my side the whole way. So gotta send a shout out to my God for really just planting the seeds for dropping the petals to get me to this spot, because I, like I said, this book was not on my radar, but it was on his radar for me to write. And so we'll start there. But I also had the Only One Mic podcast. Thank Carl Gerard for interviewing me for that. And you can find that interview on his podcast, the Only One Mic podcast. And then there's Shalina Tate, who also interviewed me from Foster My Stories. And I'd like to thank her for also investing time in interviewing me as well. So it is not just, this is not just my book. A lot of people took the time to read it and to give me advice on it. Christopher Kyle at Art is Expressive, thank you very much. Of course, Becca Sowers, thank you very much. Awesome teacher. And Julian Gooding, videographer, who has helped me as well. So all of these people have really helped me to create this character, this really strong, the strong character that I think children are going to fall in love with and really learn some lessons in the process. I know as Moses is going through this book, he's learning many different things. He's going through learning about how he stands in this world, but he's also learning to build himself up. And I think that's where a lot of children are struggling right now. They're struggling with self-confidence. They're struggling with understanding that they do have a place in this world and that they are important and they are loved. And so there are some tools and things that he has in here. And kids will also see that you're, as long as you have the desire to do better, eventually you will be better. It's nothing happens overnight. Nothing happens overnight. It sometimes takes time to get where you want to get to. And so in this book, Moses a couple of times was like, okay, now I'm going to be the best I can be. I'm not going to get into any more trouble. I'm just going to be awesome. And then one chapter later, he's in trouble again, you know, but he is trying to be a better, better person. And so I would like to read to you, I guess, there's a part in this book where he finally understands that he has to take control of himself and his actions. And the poem is called Regret, and it's actually on the back of the bookmark. So I think it's something great for students to really hone, keep in their mind as they go through learning how to control their selves, you know. And the poem is, like I said, it's called Regret, and it says, I get upset and start to sweat. My head explodes and I unload all the hurt and pain that's stuck in my brain. I don't think what's next because I'm so vexed. Then the damage is done and the gain is none. I finally learned only regret is earned when I lose control and let pain rule my soul. And so it takes a while for him to get to this point where he's really understanding that he has to take control of his emotions. And I think that's one of the most difficult things for our children today, is to understand how to breathe, take control when things are going wrong so that they can redirect it into a positive way.
But what you just said is just so applicable to adults as well, right? If I had to sum up this book, I would say it's just such an amazing reminder of the power of the words that comes from our lips, and how important it is to continuously take responsibility for planting positive words in everyone we meet, especially children. You know, the children are watching and the children are listening. So it's just for us to just be reminded, whether we're teachers or, you know, parents or friends, just family members, to remember the power we have in the words we speak and to plant positivity in everyone we meet.
Yes, yes. That is, oh my gosh, if we can just get them to be positive for 10 minutes a day. 10 minutes, I'll take 10 minutes, you know, with each other. If we could just get them to take 10 minutes to just only speak positive things for 10 minutes and then build up to 15 and build up to 20, I think we'll get somewhere. I think we are not doing a good job, and I'm talking about the adults, of showing children how to behave. We're not doing a good job of that. And that goes with the media. It goes with the songs that they are repeating over and over to themselves. It goes with what they're watching on TV and the shows. We are just not showing them how they should be together. And so they're just copying us. They're doing what we do. So I think if we can be positive with each other for 10 minutes a day, then they will eventually learn to do that. Because they're, as you say, they are mimicking what they see. And they see us fighting all the time, fussing all the time, being mean to each other all the time. The lyrics in the song that they are singing all the time isn't positive. And that trickles down into how they behave and how they treat others.
Well, I definitely want to thank you for providing positive books for our children to read. So thank you for doing your part.
Thank you. You know, I just want to uplift. My goal with my books is to uplift and inspire kids to tap into their power, you know, tap into what God has put into them. If they can just tap into that, they're going to be fine. So that's what my goal is when I write, is to just inspire children to find themselves. And so this novel, I think it's a game changer. I think it's going to spark a lot of great conversation with parents and their children. And in a classroom, it can also spark some great conversations in helping us talk about and move the needle into just treating each other a little bit better and a little bit kinder. Yes. And laugh at the same time. Have a good time at the same time.
All right. Any questions from our audience today?
No, we don't have any questions, but I'd like to thank everyone who showed up. Thank you so much. And like I said, the book is available at iwriterhymes.com. Any questions, just email me at nadine@123mangotree.com.
All right.
All right. Bye-bye. All right. Thank you, guys.